we're finally in the house. It's somewhat enclosed. We have half a roof on. There's still shooting. We ordered windows. Previously there's a 4-week lead time and we found out it's 19. So this puts us into March. So we're gonna board up the windows with some 7/16 OSB and probably frame these out a little bit so they have some strength, and then frame out the back ones. Then we can get it a little more enclosed in here. And my dad found these high bay LED lights, and they actually work really well. There's only two of them, and this is definitely enough light to work by. So it'll only be better when we get more of the roof on. It's currently 34 outside, but in here it's probably 40, 45 degrees. So very doable. It probably will only be better once the windows are boarded up. That's where we're at. Probably one of the last days where you can see through the house into the outdoors. They're working on sheathing the main roof, and then I think they've got quite a bit more in the garage. They might have gotten half of it done. The main roof here is mostly sheathed. I'm leaving a gap at the top, probably for a ridge vent. That gable end is in. We're gonna run out of light here when we go in the garage. Nope, open sky in the garage still. Got some sheathing on that side. That's it. We're still moving the high bay lights around. They definitely work good. I think if we had one on each side, it would be very bright. It definitely gets brighter when you have a surface for the light to reflect off of. It's a lot brighter. It's the light just disappears into the sky if you point it up. So we're installing our first door in the ICF wall. This is the door that's gonna go between the interior of the house and the exterior of the house. It should be a 36-inch door. We specifically got one that swings outward because we want to maintain the space inside of our mudroom area. So it's kind of a special door. We happen to find it in like the clearance bin for like half price. But you'll know right away whether or not putting your door in is going to go smooth or not based on how your opening was roughed in. And so the first thing to check is that the door should be 2 inches bigger than the door opening should be 2 inches bigger than the door. So I have a 36-inch door and I've got 38 inches here. And it should be like an inch or two taller. And so I'm just gonna measure the frame and I got like 82.5 inches, so it'll definitely fit in there. The second thing that's gonna make your life more or less painful, and it's practicable, but these would be more trimming, is check to make sure that the door jamb is plumb and both sides should be plumb. And they're perfectly plumb, so this door should go in really smooth. The next thing we're gonna do is we're just gonna clean up the sill a little bit because we're gonna be applying some sealant to seal between the bottom of the door and the concrete. So we're gonna make sure that's nice and clean. We're gonna clean up this foam as best we can so that we get really good adhesion between the sealant and the door itself. Got our front door installed. You can see how crooked the ICF is. Lucky the rough opening was big enough. Gotta put a door handle on today. Go ahead and shut this thing off so you can hear. So here's the inside of the house now. This is the gable end that you can see from inside the vaulted ceiling. So I'm thinking about framing in a window, like a kind of trapezoid shaped window. Let's go see the dormers. So we'll walk over the second half of the house. But trusses up and braced. They've got roof paper over the ridge vent to keep it dry in here until I can get out there and put shingles up. And then here are the dormers. This is just huge. This one opens up into the first bedroom, and you can see, they framed in the window. It looks like they left the OSB in there, so it basically stays boarded up over winter. Here's the other bedroom, just a flat ceiling, but there's another gable. Our safe room looks like it stayed up. I finally took the last of the braces out last week. Yeah, and now it's just freestanding. Looks like they're mostly packed up. They still have their propane bottle here and their torpedo heater. I learned early on it'll inevitably get wet in here, so
Just I put my tools on a piece of OSB with a couple 2x4 blocks on it and just keep it up off the ground. And after moving my my garage doors for the nth time, I did the same. And so now they're about 2 inches or 1.5 inches off the ground, and they don't get wet anymore. When we opened them up, everything's actually in plastic bags, so I didn't really have to worry about rust, but that was my primary concern. Some random details. Here's all the cutouts for the washing machine and dryer, and then there's a sink down there. That's a clean out for the sink vent, because it kind of goes, I don't know if you remember from my other video, but it goes up and over to connect to this vent for the washing machine. And well, that's actually a clean out for the washing machine. That's the standpipe for the washing machine. Then I've got my two pieces of PEX coming up through the floor for the washer and dryer. And I'll have to tee that off, put a washer box in, and then put a hot and cold tap for the sink that's gonna go here. I had tried to get my dryer vent in the ICF wall, but I used that 30 gauge stuff, the only stuff you can really get at the local hardware stores, and it just, it collapsed in on itself. So I'm gonna have to figure out where I could put a dryer vent somewhere else, patch that up. I got my little yard hydrants or spigots, and so these just come up through the slab, and then I have a piece of PVC in there temporarily to eventually fish my spigot through. I've got a plan for that I think is going to be pretty cool for getting that hydrant in the wall, and so I'll post a video about that later too. It is really weird actually seeing it in here with sunlight. One of my projects for today is I want to check to make sure that this door is actually square, because it feels square. It opens nice. It doesn't kind of open on its own other than the wind, but it is really not square in its rough opening. So I'm wondering who messed up, if it was me or them. It's probably, with the shim, I kind of wonder if they missed a quarter inch or something there. So we'll get that all straightened away, and then, like I said, get the door handle on, because right now it just blows open in the wind. Try and jam one of those shims in there to keep the door shut.
He's so little.
Very unhappy bat. It's finally garage door day. Wife is in the background getting the hinges on. You need to install them before you put the door up. Here's a shot of something we learned you need to do before you buy garage doors is get your trim installed. I like this PVC trim, at least for now. It seems like it's very waterproof, high quality, cuts very clean, and it's a little more expensive than just regular cedar or anything like that, but I think it's gonna be rot-free. They have these special screws that are supposed to, I'll show you a picture of one, they're supposed to sink in like that, and then there's a little plug that goes over that. Unfortunately, with my ICFs, you can see with my screw holes, I wandered, because I was trying to find the webbing. I don't think I hit the webbing once on this side of the garage door, so I'm gonna have to figure out what to do about that later. But over here I had more success. So I'm still trying to figure out how that Fox Block stuff works, the Fox Buck. But for now I'm just really struggling to hit the web. And then you gotta install what's called vinyl stop, which is the garage door actually sits up against its backside. And this stuff, you probably want to get galvanized exterior nails or some sort of trim nail. I'm just using framing nails, so these are going to rust out and look terrible, so I might end up peeling this off in a year or two anyway, but I don't have galvanized nails at the moment. Another thing you got to do before you put up garage doors is put up a jamb. So even though it's an ICF wall, I've got this 2x6 running the full length of the wall, and that's what I'm going to mount my the garage door rollers to. Got another jamb over the top to hold the spring and all that. That's just more stuff you gotta do. Putting up the garage doors is actually pretty easy. You set the first one in place, you level it with some shims. Our floor is not even remotely level. And then you just use roofing nails. You really do need a roofing nail because it's got this nice big head on it. But you just kind of pin it up against the wall and build them up one panel at a time. And it's really easy, actually. A lot easier than I did it the other way, where the rails were already in place and I tried to replace the garage door, and it's a real pain. So that's where we're at. Almost done with the first one. Note about garage doors, this is another one of those COVID supply chain shortage things. If you get anything other than this kind of hideous standard white garage door that everybody has, lead times are out till May. So you don't really got a choice. Try to get a garage door if you can, because this is the last 9-footer in stock. There are three local Menards. So we ended up driving out to one that's a little out of the way to go grab the one that was left. So thankfully we have a garage door before May, but it was close. Morgan's got the floor all swept here because Menards is supposed to drop off $4,000 in lumber, so we can start doing on our interior framing. Lumber prices were pretty insane in May. They were $1,600 per 1,000 board feet, which is kind of the unit of wood. And normally they're around $300, so you can do the math. It's like 5-6x normal cost. And then they went back down to about $600 per 1,000 board feet. And now they're back up to 1,000. So if I would have gotten this ordered last week or 2 weeks ago, I would have saved myself $2,000, but that's just how it goes. But hopefully by the end of the day, we'll have we'll have at least that garage door up. And if the lumber guy ever shows up, he was supposed to be here before noon. And I don't know, if you guys have ever ordered from Menards, their delivery is totally worth the money, but their drivers, they do not stick to a schedule. There's no way they're gonna show up on the day that they say they will, and there's no way they're gonna show up in their delivery time. So we're waiting on him. But I'm just hoping that we're gonna get the lumber today, because tomorrow is Christmas Eve, and I'm sure they're not making deliveries then. And I'm sure they're not gonna make deliveries over the weekend or Christmas Day, and I have a friend coming down next weekend to help me do some framing, so it's kinda hard to do framing if there's no lumber here. So we'll see what happens.